Anais, come on up. Anais Tangie is a food entrepreneur, and I am delighted to hear her food story, especially since she told me that her and her boyfriend have been to New Orleans on every vacation they've taken together. They haven't been anywhere else. How do you like that? I think they need to go get married in the cathedral and have their reception at Brother Orleans. So if you were a food, what would you be and why?
Well, when I was younger, I would say basil, and it would be because it's fresh and green and beautiful. But then I went to Commander's Palace, and I had their bread pudding souffle. And I created something called a slutty slow-mo of this bread pudding souffle. And it was so wrong and so decadent, and they just swish the cream and they twirl it in the souffle. And if you want to see it and understand why I've fallen in love, go to a hashtag slutty slow-mo. You'll see a series of food porn that's PG-13. It's all food, but it makes you feel something. People always react to that. So my story is about New Orleans. It's a food love story. And funny enough, it starts with Kurt Gibbs. So Kurt and I met at the SoCo Farmers Market. And I ran this farmers market, and he would show up every weekend. And he'd have an interesting magazine or some sort of food story that he'd want to tell me. And over my course at the market, it was always a great way to meet interesting people. So I would spend, it would be at least 15 to 20 minutes to spend with Kurt, because I knew he had a lot to say. And it was always exciting because it was a great distraction of the day-to-day of the market and all the hard work, and I would just be engrossed in our conversations. So flash forward to my meeting Michael Harris, who also has his own hashtag, Hot Harris. So he let me know that for my birthday, he was going to gift me a trip to New Orleans. And my birthday happened to fall on Mardi Gras Day. So what better time to experience my first ever Mardi Gras? And I had had this idea of what New Orleans was, you know, Bourbon Street and loose women and, you know, booze. And I'm like, who is this guy bringing me to booze and beads and all sorts of inappropriate things? So I was intrigued, obviously, as most people would be with that, you know, offering. So I mentioned offhand to Kurt that we were going to New Orleans, and we had talked about how much we loved, he loved the city. So he said, there is this amazing Airbnb in Treme, and you really should stay there. So he introduced us to this dear friend who now lives in LA, Jason Neville, and we booked his beautiful double shotgun, baby blue double shotgun in the middle of Treme. So we go there, and we had a series of adventures. It started with us arriving at our Airbnb, and Jason drives by with his pickup truck, and he has a yellow Sony Walkman sitting on his dashboard, and I was like, yes, I know you. And he says, I'm on my way to a bar, and let's go have barbecue. So Michael loads in the back, somebody jumps in the back with him. We speed off to Vaughn's. We watch the most magical musical performance. I was so moved, as you usually are in New Orleans when you're drinking all day. And the story of what really happened was I casually stood halfway up on the chair and did some sashaying of my own, not as a Southern Belle, but as a Canadian. And the story that Jason tells is how I stood up on the bar and proceeded to dance wildly, gesturing as a Canadian. So we had the best barbecue I've ever had in my life, and I'll come back to the food experiences that we enjoyed, but the memory of waking up in this baby blue double shotgun deep in Treme and knowing the stories as my fastidious boyfriend always researches where we're going and what we're gonna see, and we listened to WWOC because we had to become engrossed with the city and know where the live music performances were gonna be and know absolutely everything about where we're gonna go and be prepared. So I heard the stories of the skeleton crew and Mardi Gras Day, how they bang on the doors and wake people up. And I was asleep and woke up to the sound of what I thought was a skeleton crew knocking on our door. And just jumped up so thrilled that not only Mardi Gras Day, Café Du Monde coffee, a king cake that was fresh from, I'm not sure? Hedel's Bakery, and my birthday, and a parade through Jackson Square was waiting for us. So I leaped out of bed, and there may or may not have been some other extracurricular substance that accentuated the Café Du Monde coffee, the king cake, and Mardi Gras Day and my birthday. So as we prepared, you know, it was raining slightly and we dressed appropriately and we were kind of thrust into this magical day of costumes and Mardi Gras masks and this beautiful performers that had these pendants and banners and parading through entire New Orleans area. So we got to become acquainted with the city, the streets. We got to smell all these marvelous meats and these heady, kind of enthralling experiences as we walked and danced and drank through the city. And the most amazing, well, one of the most amazing things about New Orleans is that everywhere you go, you can bring a go-cup. And I consider myself a lightweight. Cheers to that.
Yeah.
Cheers. I drink about 2 drinks here in California, and I am knocked out. So I'm a cheap date.
Yeah.
But in New Orleans, you get almost a superhuman strength when it comes to booze. And it hits you right when you get off the plane. Like, there's not a stop. And I become this variation of myself, and I haven't named it because that would be weird, but almost like a diva persona who's very drunk and very witty and very happy the entire time. So we go, you know, through the city, we're parading. I think the first bite of food was this perfectly grilled pork chop that was nestled on a slice of Wonder Bread instead of a paper plate. And they just squirt this mustard all over it. And you would turn your nose up, you'd think it wouldn't be wonderful, but it really is. And it's the perfect Mardi Gras container to hold while holding your go cup, while eating your pork chop, while dancing wildly through the streets of New Orleans. So you have that feeling, you have that experience, and we just, something came over us. We fell in love more with each other, more with the city, but there was something about it. It felt like I had lived there before. There was something so familiar. And it's so funny when you get emotional talking about New Orleans. But the city is alive. And there was this waitress, or hostess, that sat down at our table at Crescent City Steakhouse And she explained to us what was so special about New Orleans. And I don't want to cry, but, you know, corny, drunk, crying. but she told us that everybody is out of the closet in New Orleans. And everybody is free to be who they want. And that's just an emotional message to allow and to let people be who they want and have equality in this city. So, okay. So that's the last of the tears. but moving back to, you know, the memory and the feeling of parading through Jackson Square and experiencing something that you can't, or maybe you can, capture in Orange County. But the color of those houses, the joy in these people's faces, and the music and the food. So coming back around to the food experience of this city, where whenever we can, the first place we go to is Galatoire's. They have a Friday lunch with 5-cent martinis. And it is the most dangerous thing that an adult could ever walk into knowingly. And you're aware, and it's really a funny, surreal moment where you have to be dressed appropriately. You're wearing a sports coat, you're wearing a suit. And if you don't, right, you have to wear a tie. And they will turn you away. And not like some hipster saying, like, no, I won't serve you another drink. They do it in that Southern style where they turn you away. And they make you feel the shame of what you walked in with. And so they have this amazing closet of these suit coats that they save for the daring gentleman that dares to walk in without a suit or a SOCO suit coat. And they never clean them, and they're hanging there in shame. Just this little sad suit coat.
And they're all green.
And they're, yes, awkward, ugly color, and just hideous. And so we acknowledge the suit coat. I look over at Hot Harris, who takes more time in front of the mirror than I. So the one problem with the Airbnb is that there was one main mirror and 2 hours of prep time for Harris and, you know, 45 minutes of prep time for me, but we always wanted to be, no, I'm kind of excited, but we always wanted to be dapper. We wanted to show a physical honoring of New Orleans. So we walked into Galatoire's. It's the Friday before New Orleans. We stood in line. We had to wait. There's a way to get in. And the gentleman at the door looked us up and down, walked away, came back with a list, didn't acknowledge us, kind of acknowledged Michael, came back. We were so confused. Are we getting into Galatoire's? Finally, they say, you're the last couple of the day. Welcome to Galatoire's. We walk in, and the surreal experience of having not only one person greet you, but five people greet you. You sit down at your table, there, somebody presents themselves as the commander of service for the day. And they serve you with grace, and they serve you with joy, and they're honored to be there, and as are we. So as we settle into a 4-hour meal, as we pride ourselves in doing whenever we go to New Orleans, you start with oysters and champagne, and you then have the oysters Rockefeller, and then you have the souffle potatoes, and if you've ever seen these little orbs of brilliance, really, I mean, Google souffle potatoes. I've never learned how to make them. I would love to. That would be a skill. Chef, I would love to learn. Thank you, chef. Thank you.
You don't always win on it.
I know. It's a very volatile. potato, so you can see through the skin. It's deep fried, so you get that fried goodness, the crunch, that dipping, but you feel like you're eating air. So you're eating and you're eating, and then the main course comes, which is our personal favorite and something that Michael orders at every restaurant pretty much in New Orleans, is the speckled trout lumiere, which is something I did learn how to do. And it was a perfectly puffed, beautifully fried trout fish that was, it takes your breath away. And when you see people making food that's so special and so spiritual and just sensual in its own way, as you'll see in the many, many slutty slow-mos that I make periodically, it elevates you to a place that is hard to achieve on your day-to-day. And so we go there all bejazzled and dressed up and drunk and eating, and we're 3 hours in and we can barely breathe, and all of a sudden an entire second line parade walks into Galatoire's. And it was my first second line experience, and I see the hysteria and everybody jumping up and swinging their napkins.
And the second line.
So a second line opera. Second line is when a band leads a parade of people wildly swinging the napkin, as we'll see in this gesture of our host face. Perfect, thank you. I love it. My favorite. And it goes on and on, and this live band with trumpets and saxophones and drums and costumed men and this entire restaurant on their feet, and we've already experienced heaven and we've already tasted what I consider to be my best bite of food, and it just does something to you. It changes your DNA, and it has never left us. We have gone to New Orleans 12, 13 times. We haven't traveled anywhere else. We have stayed in Jason's Treme Airbnb until he found a wife. He got her pregnant. He sold his Treme house. He moved to LA. And he's now the man that I'm working with for my business. So thank you, Kurt. And I love the hilarity of life bringing me full circle in front of Kurt, talking about Jason Neville and the house in Treme. Wow. And just what a special, special memory.
Thank you. Oh, wow. What a beautiful way to end. Meanwhile, back at Cal.